ourselves. The stories have become what people refer today as our narrative, how we narrate ourselves, our lives, and how we narrate ourselves actually is a construct of time. Narrative in our civilization is something that has a beginning, proceeds, there's a plot to the story, there's conflict, World War II, World War I, the wars before and before, all the civilization, conflict, and then supposedly resolution. But then narrative is also a byproduct of the fact that we stopped seeing ourselves as just being in this diverse world. We became dependent on narratives and stories. We became stories. And part of this direction with the stories is also how we construct the image of ourselves, what we call identity, and how we transmit this identity, this narrative, linear narrative, to our stories. And there are stories outside of this narrative that are not stories, that have nothing to do with time. Aboriginal people, for example, you know, you go to the non-domesticated, say Inuit, well, Russian Inuits, or you know, in Lapland, you listen to their the way they tell stories, and you can't make sense of it. There's no time frame. There's no logic. There's no moral of the story. It's just a moment of being together. So, in my work and in what I want to share with you tonight, I noticed that the civilized narrative is very similar regardless of where you look. The stories, like even in religion, it starts with Genesis, you know, starts with wilderness. And how does all of a sudden the creation of time, of toil, of how we live, how we know ourselves, how we know the world, and what we do with it. The question, the very elemental question, becomes what we eat and who we are. And basically that's the introduction of what I will be talking about. I will be talking about these different ways of telling our stories and transmitting them to children and undoing the narrative and the story, which is very similar in all the disciplines if it's taught within domestication and civilization, and it's very different from the wilderness. So that is the introduction. In 2008, December, I went to the Modern Language Association convention in California. They had a wonderful session with California Indian storytellers, giving their version on, you know, this scientific, you know, the major association that controls, you know, the production of what we think about language, how we're supposed to use language, and, you know. And it was really, you know, a very important point that Darrell Bade Wilson, in his story, and actually in his prologue to the story, and his conclusion of the story, about the creation of the world. And his story was that the world was created as a song. that there was thought. It was divine thought. And it responded to that song. And it created a world for the birds, for the children, and for everyone. And he said that the way we see creation, how this world was created, what for, how we were created and what for, is ultimately going to define how you're going to be in this world. And it's very close, again, to the Genesis. For example, in Genesis 1:29, when God creates, in consecutive days, and on the last day he rests. On the sixth day he creates the animals and the people, and he tells them, "Behold, I have given you every plant yielding every plant yielding seed, in order for you to consume, in order for you not to consume each other and to be together." In this diverse world. And it's a good world, it's a diverse world, because it was created that way. And God says, be fruitful and multiply every time he creates somebody. He doesn't say that people be fruitful. And this is what the agriculturalist take was. People multiply. Be fruitful and multiply, so have 12 children each. Because you have to take over the land and kill the wilderness and domesticate everybody else. And actually this version of the good, diverse environment is also, it's confirmed in other stories. For example, in primatologists, you know, the people who study the primates, the bigger apes, and the simians, you know, the monkeys and, you know, all the primates. So they see that out of all of these very close relatives, we are the only ones who have come to see the world as our possession, as our food. Gibbons sometimes, or chimps, you know, again, you know, due to human colonizing, deforestation and colonizing the world for agricultural purposes, have nowhere to go, sometimes would, you know, eat, you know, pick what's there. But most are vegans, just as all the stories are telling us we should be. And yet it's, you know, the civilized story, which is now our official narrative in science and, you know, from religion, the stories that are given us as the example of how not to be, what not to do, even the whole the original sin, Adam and Eve get punished with agriculture, with toil. You are going to eat differently now. Before, you were in a good world. You were greedy, you disobeyed. So now, you are going to have to work really hard, domesticate. And it's really, I noticed, I work with the secular, you know, the daily, you know, the supposedly neutral, you know, children's stories that have no political agenda, no religious thought behind it. They're just harmless children's books, and they're really good. And therefore, they should be taught in, you know, this really good, for some reason, obligatory schools. You know, if schools were so good, they wouldn't be obligatory, right? Everybody would want to go to school. Why are they obligatory? That's another story. And what is being taught in this? First of all, apart from the literary genre, what's taught, I attended several, you know, classes just to observe, you know, how is, for example, creative art taught in the school. Well, the teacher comes, okay, children are going to have 45 minutes of art, creative activity. So sit down and watch what I do. 20 minutes instructions. And then everybody has to repeat, and they get graded according to how well they repeated what the teacher, that's creative. But apart from that, there's the story of what you are creating. Full time, we have, oh, you know, these colors are because we have pumpkin, you know, the leaves are orange and the pumpkins are orange. Everything is being related to what you consume, what you dominate, and what you need. It's for you. The colors are for you. The change of seasons are for you. Everything is for you. And if it's not for you, it's for some reason, because ultimately it comes back to you. So a very good example I observed in Montreal, actually also in 2000. So it was, it was at a library, a United Nations session. It was a summer session, you know, so it was, you know, kids who supposedly weren't, didn't have to be there, but still, you know, they also went to schools, you know, giving the same, like, teaching about biodiversity. And so the animators told, okay, we're going to learn about biodiversity, you know, what exists in the world, you know, draw what you know. So the kids sit and, you know, for a chance, like, they have to be creative, and some of them are stressed, but, you know, they draw whatever they, you know, they can, and most of them drew like one little thing and were really embarrassed. And then Stephanie, one of the animators, goes, oh, so Michael, what did you draw? What are these? He says, trees. Why are trees important? Because they give us fresh air. It's important. Zoe, what have you drawn? A lake. Why are lakes important? They have water. Yes, water is very important. Without water, we will die. Zaki, what do you have there? This is a zebra, that is a lion, this is a tree, and there is a bird, and here is the sun. Very good, Zaki. Why are zebras important? They run, and they are pretty with stripes. Who eats the zebras? Prompts Stephanie. The lions? Yes! The zebras are important for the lions to eat. The sun is important because without it we will die. And I'm thinking, okay, Zaki will grow, might join the United Nations, and will be in a position to pass a law to exterminate the lions because they eat too many zebras, and now zebras have a different function. He will have a say over whether the lions will ever die. he will have is say, all of us are raised from childhood to think of us knowing the other as existing for a reason we know. And this knowledge is the root of oppression. And you look at so-called secular, you know, harmless literary creative stories. And you will notice, I'll read you one, I don't know how many of you have read Charlie and the Chocolate Factory. Everybody knows. Okay, so where is that little piece and what is it about? Win some tickets to go and see the secretive chocolate factory. And how one of them is going to be the one who obeys the best will be chosen as an heir to this, you know, to this business venture. So who does Willy Wonka have working for his in his factory? Anyone remembers? Uncle Lucas. Where do they come from? Okay, originally they were from Africa, but then he was forced to make them rosy and make them from Lumpaland, but everything else remains very specific. So, they're imported. This is a quote. The Lumpa Oompas imported direct from Lumpaland, said Mr. Wonka proudly. I ship them all over here, every man, woman, and child in the Oompa Loompa tribe. It was easy. I smuggled them over in large packing cases with holes in them. They are wonderful workers. They all speak English now. They love dancing and music. Okay. That's what Oompa Loompas apparently exist for. And what does he have to say about their country? Very Darwinist. They just cannot, and it actually also is very much in line with what Nikisha was saying earlier. Inferior races, they cannot survive without the colonizer. And what a terrible country it is. Nothing but thick jungles infested by the most dangerous beasts in the entire world. A Wongadugo would eat 10 Oompa Loompas for breakfast and come galloping back for a second helping. When I went out there, I found the little Oompa Loompas living in tree houses. They had to live in tree houses to escape from the Wongadugos. And they were practically starving to death. They were living on green caterpillars, and caterpillar states of revolting. And the Oompa Loompas spent every moment of the day climbing through the treetops looking for other things to mash up with the caterpillars to make them taste better. Red beetles, for instance, eucalyptus leaves, Poor little Oompa Loompas. The one food that they longed for more than any other was cacao bean, which actually grew in their land. But they couldn't get it. Miserable, stupid Oompa Loompas, huh? Who gets the cacao beans? Who has the factory?
Yeah.
The smart, good Willy Wonka. An Oompa Loompa was lucky if he found 3 or 4 cacao beans a year, but oh, how they crave them. They used to dream about cacao beans all night and talk about them. I myself use billions of cacao beans every week in this factory, and so my dear children. As soon as I discovered that the Oompa Loompas were crazy for this particular food, I climbed up to their treehouse village, poked my head in through the door of the treehouse belonging to the leader of the tribe. The poor little fellow, looking thin and starved, was sitting there trying to eat a bowl full of mashed up green caterpillars without being sick. "Look here," I said, speaking not English, of course, but in Oompa Loompish. "Look here. If you and all your people will come back to my country and live in my factory, you can have all the cacao beans you want. I've got mountains of them in my storehouses. You can have cacao beans for every meal. I'll even pay your wages in cacao beans, if you wish." "You really mean it?" asked the Oompa Loompa leader. "Of course I mean it." And so I shipped them all over here, in the crates. And they make wonderful workers, they love dancing, and now they speak English. Okay. What's important, like, what's striking about this? What is it about?
The assumption that jungles are bad.
Jungles are bad. Wilderness is dangerous. Don't venture out there, children. There are all sorts of things, and you won't be able to get your chocolate because I have it.
So this story is consumption, overconsumption, or something like
consumption.
Overconsumption.
Overconsumption, or either even consumption and control of that consumption. You control what the other consumes. The Oompa Loompas cannot eat the food that grows in their own land. They have to work for the foreigner to be able to eat the beans. And ultimately, even the stories that don't talk about food are still about it. But imagine, and this is a bestseller. I mean, recently it keeps getting prizes. Like even as recent as, you know, a couple of years ago, it got like, you know, a major prize. These are the stories that children read. I mean, as an exercise, think of this story. Imagine a best-selling children's book depicting an Arab sheikh poking his head into the windows of an American, Canadian, European home. What he sees shocks him. Miserable people and their children eating processed food. While there are pears growing all over the place. And when it is pears they crave the most. "Oh, look at those poor skinny fellows," says the chef. "All those pears are growing around them and they can't even have them. I feel so sorry for you. If you come with me to Arabia and work for me in my factory making pear pies, you can have all the pears you want." When the tiny, skinny, and miserable American, Canadian, and European chief sees the sheikh's face and learns of his magnanimous intentions to save him from his misery, he welcomes the liberator and begs the sheikh to deliver all of the Americans, Canadians, or Europeans from their atrocious lot. Guided by the generosity of his heart, the sheikh grabs every child, woman, and man in the country, sticks them in a crate, pokes holes in it, and smuggles them into Arabia where they live happily ever after in his factory, receive pears for wages, speak Arabic, and sing and dance. Have you heard of this bestseller? No, neither have I. Well, I'm not buying to this structure, so I'm not going to buy it. This is an exercise to show how, you know, the notions of genesis and domestication have entered, you know, you know, our very basic structure, expectation, and what, like, what we've made available and what we we have been subjected to as children, and what our children get subjected to, whether we like it or not. You know, even my kid who doesn't go to school knows about all these things. And race in this context becomes one of these really important structural mechanisms. Mm-hmm. And you cannot, I grew up not seeing it. I decided to be a vegan before I was even 5 years old. But it's every time you come across what is being imposed by this knowledge and what is being imposed on our children. But I don't want it to be completely pessimistic, because there are ways of challenging these. And there's the beautiful books, the Moomin books, for example. They challenge this narrative in several ways. First of all sorts of creatures. Everybody, there's no identity. You are not an Arab, you are not a European, you are not a human. You are what you are. And you thrive because the world is wild, and you wouldn't be able to thrive without this wilderness, without movement. You know, again, Nikisha talked about nation state locks you in. You don't move. When you stop moving, what is that? When do you stop moving, apart from being paralyzed?
When
you're dead. We're locked in death, in the knowledge of death, in the structure of death that oppresses us to the core. What we eat, how we conceive of ourselves, is our death, is how we murder the planet and ourselves. We have become the only species that reproduces, are fruitful and multiplies, because we eat each other. And everything else dies. Thousands of species disappear because of this knowledge, because of this fear to venture into the jungle and feel safe in it, because it is good. So the Moomin books are about that. So here I am. But don't buy them, because the niece now is, the niece of the author is now making it into a brand. So it's also, everything sooner or later becomes a brand. Unfortunately, the author passed away recently. So now the niece has a say. So here is a little example of how Moomin Mama allows her child to learn. There's in the book, there's one of these creatures is the Brook. And let me find that citation. Okay. So the Brook is because the Moomin world is wilderness, but it's not, you know, like this, you know, happy-go-lucky, nothing ever happens. There are dangers. You know, creatures sometimes might attack others. They don't domesticate them. Other creatures don't exist for their purpose. But it's a realistic world with dangers. And yet, the only way to be in that world is to find out, is to learn about that danger. How are we going to learn about that? How are we going to learn about the other that we don't know? And who's the other until we get to know them? So there's the Grope. And the Grope, she appears in book three. She's like this ultimate fear. And when she appears, the world freezes around her. Everything dies. So, Moomin Mama explains to her son, we're afraid of the, Moomin Troll asks her, why are we afraid of the Brook? We're afraid of the Brook because she's just pulled all over, and because she doesn't like anybody. but she's never done any harm. In other words, Moomin Mama believes that the group has a right not to like others, and in no way should we be afraid of her or intolerant of her just because she dislikes us. After all, it's deeds that count, not knowledge or lack of it. The group, did somebody do something to her to make her so awful, asks Moomin Cho. No one knows, said Moomin Mama. It was probably because nobody did anything at all. Nobody bothered about her. I mean, I don't suppose she remembers anyhow. And I don't suppose she goes around thinking about it either. She's like the rain or the darkness or a stone you have to walk around if you want to get past. So it is indifference and apathy that breeds horror. And in, I think it was book six or seven, they're on an island, and Moomin parents allow their child to find out about this group who instills fear and freezes everything. Moomin Troll could hear the beating of the island's heart. Suddenly, the Brook started to sing because he was waiting for her. There was no doubt about it. The Brook was pleased to see him. She didn't mind about the hurricane lamp. She was delighted that he had come to meet her. Somehow, he knew that she wasn't afraid of being disappointed anymore. But the most important thing that drove him to start these daily appointments with the group was, in one point of the book, the author tells us, Moomin Troll wondered what it was like to be so alone, what it was like to be her. And he gave her the warmth. And as the meetings continued, he kept going to meet, to see her. One day he forgot the lamp. And he's like, oh my God, I'm going to see her. She's waiting for me. I cannot let her down, but I forgot the hurricane lamp. And when he came without the lamp, she fell because the warmth that she was looking for was in his commitment. That was his light. And I would like to end on this, that there are ways of telling stories that are not our narrative. They're not the narrative of domestication and civilization. They're available everywhere, in every religion, in every scientific endeavor, in every art. And they're opposing forces of domestication that are in every religion, in every scientific endeavor, everywhere. Sometimes, unfortunately, it seems to me the latter forces are overpowering. But when I see people like you, questions, and people who live, who make these choices of finding out how to know ourselves and the world in a different way, you know, I think we can do it.
A question for Layla. I think one of the things that I would love to hear you clarify, particularly in this circle, as someone who is also vegan, is there is the sort of primitivist push that one of the ways we get back to wilderness is by killing other animals. And so there's a big emphasis on hunting, as a spiritual sort of thing, and that's the place where I get to know my fellow animal, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And so how do you deal with the anthropology, or how do you see yourself holding an anti-civilization bent and something that is also very respectful of of the life as, of non-human animals, not as something that we use to re-enter jungle, but as something that we can be partners and participants with.
Absolutely, absolutely crucial question, because actually it appears that the biblical text and the scientific evidence both point to the fact that we're not meant to be carnivores. That in dire situations, you know, there were catastrophes, and in dire situations we were driven to scavenge and perhaps hunt. I mean, it's not very clear, you know, that, you know, and it's not very clear, there's different theories that, you know, domestication actually started off with switching to that carnivorous mentality. Mm-hmm. When you observe the animals that are carnivorous, they're very careful. I mean, they're very lazy. They sleep a lot and they eat very little. Lions catch one gazelle, the whole tribe eats it, and they sleep. Our sleeping patterns point to the fact that we are not meant for this diet and for this lifestyle. We don't sleep that much. So it really is not healthy. Again, you know, in ecological catastrophes, apparently we can detect, you know, that it happened a couple of times, but not enough to switch, you know, permanently into this domestication. And actually this point that you raised is really important also to the, you know, harkens back to your presentation earlier, that hunter-gatherers, the real hunter-gatherers, are constructed racially in that structure that Nikisha presented today, you know, as this primitive, you know, this miserable, poor lot. You know, it's like, you know, either they will die out or just, you know, push them somewhere and try to civilize them and, you know, throw them some cheese every now and then, you know, so they don't die. It's like, it's not respectable. Unschooling families who are of color, unschooling families of color who want to go and live the nomad life, are constructed as this danger. I mean, they would be shot by the cops, you know, they wouldn't even pass, you know, cross country. They'd be exterminated in, as we found out, I keep calling Manitoba, it's the other side, Montana. Mm-hmm. Montana, Arizona, whatever, Texas. Mm-hmm. Because they're constructed as, well, that's essentially your nature, your primitive nature. Of course you are like that. Because you are like that, you're danger to us because you want what we have and you're not going to have it. You're going to have what we decide we know about you and what you're going to have. So it ends up this big primitivist movement is white, because white people can get away with it. And I'm not saying that white people will choose to do it, you know, do not renounce a lot of their privileges. They do, but they cannot erase that privilege of being white and being allowed to sacrifice and to suffer, but to live. Mm-hmm. You know, and so it becomes a game that depends on a lot of what goes on, all the oppression that goes around of the real people, you know, the real nomads in Israel who are being exterminated, the Bedouins who are not human, the real nomads in Lapland, in northern Scandinavia. I mean, they're hardly ever, you know, the nomads in Africa, all the frontiers, all the desertification. They used to be able to live, the desert was full of life. It is no longer. And they cannot even escape the way, like, a white family would choose to go and be nomads and, you know, and travel on the road. Oh, you know, well, funny white people, they do funny things sometimes, but it's okay. The Somalis were escaping an incredible situation, like incredible violence in their homeland. They cannot, I don't know if you've heard this summer, a boat of Somalis was stranded in the Mediterranean, and every country is observing, like, which, they're in international waters, okay, but which waters are they going to cross, so that country will take care of them. So finally they ended up in the wave or whatever took them into the Libyan side. So the Libyan government grabs them, puts them in the middle of the desert, there's a prison, no water, prison. They're not nomads, they're not considered gatherers, they will never ever have a chance to play that game. So, this is a luxury, to have this, that depends on others not having that luxury. And also the hunting part is that, again, you know, going after the animals, it means that the people who do that haven't really undone that human identity, that my people are the bears. You know, you go to this is a beautiful guy, like Tim Ingold, he works with, he writes a lot on anthropology of pastoralists and nomads. And he said, for the Ojibwe, the bear is a person. It's not that the Ojibwe don't know that the bear looks different and might attack him, but he's a person. And there are certain ways when the way you have to deal with that person. The transformations, I talk in my research, I don't have a chance to touch on that. The way that the native people believe, and in the stories also, like the Moomin Troll stories, the way transformation, the way you can transform into another, you become the animal, it adds to your knowledge. But in civilization, you cannot cross that border, you cannot become the animal, you hunt him. Even as someone who rebels against the system of domestication, you still hunt that other. It's not only race, it's not only the color of the skin or the curliness of the hair. It's whether you walk on four, whether you have a tail. That's also discrimination. Mm-hmm. And that's really part of that knowledge. Mm-hmm. So thank you for that question.
We've made a golden crucifix. Everybody gets the day. To get marked by the snake. Become one you hate and that's how the world is seen. We're being bled dry. A blood is fueling this machine. We must go on producing. Until our memories wipe clean, we'll make a new earth. A new heaven, a new hell, and even a new God. Better than the one you've got, one we can package and good and drunk. You do just as you're told. You love everything you've got. Your body and soul. Oh, come out now. Come out soon. You can't be lying with a bullet of shall lead you to your death.